Thank you to ChemAxon for allowing me to come to their birthday party. It's been a great couple of days. I also wish I'd known before I put the title together that ChemAxon had a time machine. Then I wouldn't have to speculate on what the future was going to be, like I've just found out. It might have helped me to remind me what happened in the past. So some of you may have heard me present, it turns out, 6 years ago. So what I'm going to do is bring you to where we were 6 years ago, and then show you what's happened in the last 6 years and where we are at the present, and then a couple of personal speculations on what to do in the future, or what might happen in the future. So there was life before ChemAxon. I even had life before 1998 as well, as a medicinal chemist. I started in 1982, and in 1982 there were no computers that chemists had access to. It was a year later before I started to calculate things like log P, more the refractivity. But this is where we'll start from. So what were we doing in 1998? Well, I was part of the Glaxo Welcome organization, and the kind of tools that we were using were, well, the classic form view of the time was MDL isospace. We used isosdraw. We had done a lot of work with Daylight. A lot of their software was implemented within our organization. But then there was an awful lot of in-house developed tools, a whole mess of them, as you'll discover later. But if you thought that was a mess, then 2 years later, a bigger mess turned up in terms of integration of anything. The GlaxoSmithKline-Beecham merger, which took place in December of 2000. I remember the party, by the way, for the end of GW. That was a great party too, by the way. I'll leave that one for now. So we had all the problem of having our own tools from the GW organization, plus we had all the tools that were being used in the SmithKline merger. There was a decision to make the best of both for data systems applications, but that isn't really what happened, I would say. That's my personal view. There were about 10 research sites that came from the legacy organizations. There were sites in the US, in the UK, that barely spoke to each other. There were sites in Italy. There were sites in other places as well. And so they all had their way of doing things. So we let some time pass, and it's a long time we allowed to pass. And then we got to 2009, where we decided we had to simplify things and also do something about the cost. I think MDL and Daylight were beginning to really put their prices up. So we had a nice acronym called CRISP for simplifying our environment. There was 520 application components. Not only was it complex, but it was incredibly fragile. Lots of inter-application dependencies, and there was overlapping. You know, there was things, people doing things were exactly the same or very close to being the same in different parts of the organization. And because some of them predated the merger, some of them were getting a bit old, some were obsolete. So what we put together was this project, as part of the overarching CRISP program, was this SAR Tools replacement project. And that SS is me. I was the business lead, so I got about 8 chemists together from around the organization, US, UK, former SB, former GW, Italy, and we put together a group. And the goal was to simplify our desktop. Too many applications, although as we discovered, some were truly loved by some parts of the community. And just as some were loved by some parts of the community, some of the others that were loved by other parts of the community were hated by the first community. So it was impossible to get any agreement in saying, can we get rid of one and use the other one? So it was better to actually just tear them all up and start again. So there's ISIS over here. This was one of my loves, by the way, chemically-aware spreadsheet. Lovely one, autostructure chem retriever discovery explorer. So can we get rid of all of these and can we replace them? So what we did was we set about building our own application which could deal with the accessing of data, particularly biological data, which was done before with Discovery Explorer. But what we knew was the ICIS component wouldn't be fed by this. And this is when we came across Instant JChem. And it's a terrible thing to say, is that even now, if you ask most chemists who makes the Instant JChem application, ChemAxon is not what they come to mind. Chemists know things by the applications. That's the name. They don't really know very much about the vendors. So if you wanted your name to be known a bit better, you should have somehow got ChemAxon into the name so we can see it. Otherwise, we know it as Instant JChem. This tool, Helium, operated within Excel and Spotfire. So for a chemist, we required some structural rendering. And for that, we decided to use JChem for Excel to do this. Okay, this is it in a graphic form. There's all these applications, and we're going to take care of most of them, build our own sort of a Helium. It sits inside Excel, it sits inside Spotfire, and we used the JChem for Excel for rendering structures in Excel, and there's also a JChem plugin for rendering structures in Spotfire as well. And then at the bottom here, we've got this, remove the huge number of IsisNet forms aware, IsisBase, and replace them with Instant JChem. Okay, first things first, 2009, we developed this, JChem for Excel. We did get rid of all of those. And surprisingly, because chemists are a fairly unforgiving lot, they got a very enthusiastic uptake by the chemists and scientists in general. And there were no tears shed for the loss of these legacy applications. And inside about 6 months, people had forgotten about all these. They were quite happy using Helium. And JChem for Excel worked beautifully in terms of structural rendering too. So they were happy. Also, something the users never knew about was the whole business to do with the cartridge and the toolkit. This is something that users don't think about at all. They know something happens, magic, when they hit a button, but no one really thinks about it happening or how it's done. But much more of an issue was ISIS, moving away from the ISIS suite of tools to these strange things called Marvin. People wondered why it was called Marvin. I must ask someone sometime how you got the name Marvin. But there we go. And this was something which was truly embedded in a whole number of particularly lead optimization programs. But they were told, no, you're going to move from this. I remember having a fight over the people who were still using ISIS for Excel. They wanted to continue to use it. We eventually told them, no, you had to move away. We're simplifying things. However, and this is what I talked about 6 years ago, when we started running tests on Instant JChem, we discovered there was a huge drop in performance once we moved outside the UK. I think the structure in the assay databases are about 150 yards from where I sit. So I get pretty good performance, and I'm not too unhappy about it. But once you go across the Atlantic, and we also discovered, even if you went as far away as France, that the performance still fell down. And China had the problem as well. So there you go. That doesn't work. So they decided to implement, again, things that we didn't understand called Citrix servers. And you had to access the US, anywhere turned outside the UK, you had to access through the Citrix servers. So that's where we were when I presented last time. And what I said was, is what we now have is a two-tier IJC experience. The users in the UK are quite happy. They're happy to take on IJC, and it becomes absolutely integral to many UK discovery programs. It is the tool of choice for the chemist who likes the form view for doing lead optimization, and they all start building into this. Meanwhile, outside of the UK and the US, you've got this lack of performance, and there is a Citrix barrier. When you actually spoke to them, it turned out that actually getting into Citrix, by the time you fired up Instant JChem, your coffee had gone cold, and so it was time to do something else. So they began to develop their own sort of little methods for doing SAR. Fortunately, they had JChem for Excel, so they began to produce these living Excel spreadsheets that kept on adding compounds to all the time. So that's when I gave the presentation. So we decided, I'm not sure who it was, I think maybe it was ChemAxon, that Plexus Connect was the direction to go. And the real plus was that a web solution would improve the performance in the US. So we could get everything working well in the US, we would increase uptake and usage. A smaller point, but we had a number of applications at this time which had some Java compatibility. And every time Java moved, it produced a problem. So we're quite happy to get away from the Java of the IJC thick client. But I said 2016. That was a rather traumatic time in the world of GSK. We began to close sites down again. And unfortunately, most of the key people that I had worked with for many years in the IT side out at the Research Triangle Park in North Carolina, they were all going to leave. The site was closing down, or the R&D part was closing down at the end of the year. So now there's a rush to get Plexus Connect launched before this IT group was broken up. The thing that really suffered is that the business users weren't really engaged. It was, you know, we're going to deliver something to the business and you're going to use it because we're gone and out of here. But then the UK chemists, the ones who really use sort of IJC, they were really concerned about the performance they were getting when they were using Plexus Connect project forms. And I got a bunch of users together, and the general message was, is you just cannot take us away from the thick client. You just can't. It would be unacceptable. So I spoke to the IT people, and they said, you can't launch, and you can't launch. So that was at the end of 2016. However, and money isn't something I think about very much, but this project cost money. And so at the end of the year, with Plexus not launched, the question was, well, what did you do with all that money? So I said, well, really, we do want Plexus Connect if we can get things right. So I went to the IT group and said, we want to do it. And it's going to cost even more money, of course, to do it. So they made a condition, an absolute condition, which, as I said, we were quite happy to go with. Was if we're going to run a project again, then you're going to have to get business people more closely within the project. So we got two chemists, one from the UK, one in the US, to sit on the IT project team. So they were involved in the decision-making. And also the people who were the form owners were getting into the testing right away. So the proposal was, as it was presented to us at the time, is the thick client would be used for form design, for administrative purposes, and that Plexus Connect would be the tool for querying by program scientists. So I have to say, and you know, you can see down here what happened, that I think this worked very well. I think ChemAxon, we're very pleased to having direct access to users, so they actually understand what the problems were that people were talking about. And the chemists were quite happy to be speaking directly to the people who would understand their problems too. So there was issues with the migration, there was forms, there was all sorts of things going on. And also what we discovered when we're doing the testing is that whereas the thick client was fairly tolerant, if it found an error, the web tool was much less fault tolerant. And so, form by form, we had to get things fixed and out the other side. So, launched in August of last year. Now, I think I told you earlier on, chemists are an unreasonable lot. When I'm a chemist, we complain when things aren't going well. So the best news is that things have gone very quiet. And very quiet is a good thing in the world of sort of IT. So, last week, I got a few chemists in the US and some in the UK to run some standard queries, structure queries, structure and data queries. And I showed Carla the numbers yesterday. And it's what people now believe is the performance of the thick client and the web client are effectively the same when it comes to structure searching. In terms of the US, we see almost no difference at all now between the performance in the US and the UK. And as a consequence, the US are now using sort of a Plexus Connect, and the scientists are happier, which is great. So you can do the form design and the editing in the thick client. That doesn't rely much of a connection, so that's quite effective. But they're now using the Plexus Connect for the querying as it was designed. The UK is a bit different. There are people who have got their IJC forms, been using them for the last, say, few years, and they're quite happy to stick with IJC. Whereas new projects coming along, they do the building in IJC and they're using Plexus Connect the way the model's designed. Chemists are never completely happy, and there are still some things in terms of functionality which we'd like to see and hopefully we'll get when I come to the next slide. But what about JChem for Excel, with this wonderful thing which is sitting in Excel? I think we managed this badly. When we got JChem for Excel, the only thing we were interested in was the structure rendering as alongside Helium. Helium did all the work, and JChem for Excel just produced the structures. The chemists slowly but surely began to discover these things. No one had advertised them, and they began to use them. But even more so were the JChem functions. I think it probably took about a year and a half before someone actually realized that the JChem functions were sitting there. Because they're always the ones that are last in the list when you try to get a function. They're almost invisible. So we didn't promote them, and then people started to use these as well. And the favorite one, and this is for biologists too, is the one which names molecules. However, the other thing is I use it for manipulating SD files that come in from collaborators. I don't think we've got another tool for doing that at all, so it's absolutely essential for that. The only downside is we moved to Microsoft Office 2016. But ever since we've done it, the opening of Excel with the add-ins just takes longer. One particular of the add-ins, if you remove it, disable it, it's a bit faster. But even so, opening Excel can take between about 30 seconds and a minute, and the chemists are complaining about this again. So hopefully, if we get to JChem for Office, Akos assures me, he's over there. Akos assures me that this will improve things. So pressure's on, Akos. There you go. Right. It's okay. It's all done. Right. So what are we doing in the future? Some of the future we have a little bit, hopefully, control of. This is our JChem landscape. And you'll notice that there are no two things that are the same version here. I'm slightly concerned, by the way, that ChemAxon, the names they're choosing for their new versions. Yes, argon is stable, yes, but barium? Do you really want someone to start playing with something called barium? I'm not convinced. Think of a better name for that one, something a bit more stable. Anyway, one thing we're hoping for with JChem for Excel or JChem for Office, we have run into problems when we've done our migrations. Because we use Excel for this, when we've moved from version to version, we went from 2007 to 13 to 16. But we're now in what's called the Microsoft Elevator. So we're hoping that being on a standard support version of this will help us deal with this Microsoft Elevator. So that's in the short term. Hopefully that will all be done this year. Then some of this, I think, would like to be done this year, but maybe later on in the year. I imagine most companies are into big data, and we're no exception. We've got Hadoop platform. And some of our other tools are connecting this to the Hadoop platform. So the question is, why isn't Plexus Connect connecting to the Hadoop platform? So we'd like to see that happening. We'd like to see some of these tools. I'd love to see a really nice integration of Plexus Connect with Spotfire, the way I asked for it 6 years ago, by the way, when I was here, but never mind. And also, some of our group are into this concept of containerization, which I do not understand, but one of the technical people said, we really should be thinking of containerizing Plexus. So I think that's something I've still got to mention to Bastic. I was told I had to speak to him when I came here. However, now we got on to real speculation. So, two things. For anyone who's put an IJC together, actually getting hold of the data, linking it all up, putting the widgets in, you have to know what you're doing. It takes a long time. And we've got so much more data that's coming along. It's what I'm looking for, since we can actually send out a command, go find all the data for a compound, and it will come back for some of our systems. So it knows where the data is. So why can't it go and actually just create the links to the data? And then some kind of smart form. I was talking to one of the ChemAxon folk yesterday. When you've got a certain amount of data in Spotfire, it'll suggest the kind of visualization you want to actually use that kind of data. So why couldn't we have a smart form that actually says, I know what your data is, how do you want to look at it? So that's the first thing here. There's lots more data. So we'd like a compound CV. We'd like it in some kind of formish view, but not one that we have to actually spend a lot of time creating and recreating. And this is my last little piece. It says that the age of the medicinal chemist is fast drawing to a close. Well, the career of this particular medicinal chemist is very fast drawing to a close. And I've been watching what's been happening in the areas of models and algorithms, machine learning, and the impact that has on the design tools we're using. So I'm not talking about the job of a chemist as in synthesizing compounds. I'm talking the medicinal chemist as designing new molecules. I've seen MADFAST, I've seen other ways to actually make molecules and evaluate them. So that has, for many years, to me, is what distinguishes the medicinal chemist from other chemistry roles. And I'm a bit concerned that we won't need so many medicinal chemists. Now, if I had my time machine, I'd find out whether that was going to be in 2 years' time or 5 years' time or 10 years' time. But I think it's definitely going to happen. So looking at the tools which ChemAxon are making now, what are ChemAxon doing to actually think of themselves? Their users may not necessarily be medicinal chemists in the future. Their users may well be other machines, bots, robots, or something that way. So I'm going to head off into the sunset of my retirement sometime fairly soon. And I'm hoping that some of the medicinal chemists who are in our company have got a job for a reasonable amount of time. But I'm just not sure how much time that will be. OK, thanks very much for your attention. Happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
So you probably guessed I will comment.
It couldn't be
this.
About GKM for office, could it?
No, no. But we discussed this, so you know, but maybe others don't know that. Basically, 1 year ago at the UGM, we showed that we removed shared adding, that component which is responsible for the slow loading. So it's not there anymore. Just maybe large pharma companies are not that fast to go to a newer version.
Yeah, we can't move versions very quickly. I think that's one of the reasons we're looking forward to these LTS versions that we can get onto.